some work. But yeah, that means the sniper gets through, not banned out by Team Tinker, who opted for the wristband once again next to the troll. So we do have this very popular, very strong carry hero. Strong early in the laning stage, strong later in terms of right clicks. Especially together with Ventral Spirit, being able to ride that little bit of minus armor, plus early game roaming potential here to maybe try and keep the sniper safe just by keeping attention off of him. On the other hand, Team Tinker have a lot of space to a lot of space and time in the draft to work around that sniper, and we already see that here in the first two picks. Queen of Pain, a hero that can jump straight on top of the sniper, burst him down. Clockwork, not similar. He can close the distance quickly, can isolate the sniper, and make sure that he doesn't have the impact that he wants in the fight.
Mm-hmm. Especially considering the sniper usually won't go for a BKB, at least not early on, if any time. So, you know, you add that up on top of, you know, a quick mask of madness, and it's pretty much, for a clockwork, the sniper becomes kind of like a more, I would say, beefier draw ranger for him. Pretty much that's what it comes down to, is the fact that, okay, once you hook him and get him onto cogs and, you know, your battery assault, sniper really doesn't have that many choices to do. Now, with that said, of course, if the sniper is able to get a lot of farm and get ahead quite quickly, he might be an issue. It's one of those times, like, when the clockwork doesn't have his blade mail, and at the same time, the sniper is able to just get his mask of madness and on top of, like, a Sangin Yasha or, God forbid, a freaking Scotty, then it's, like, pretty much the one way to get for the clockwork, because it's going to be Suicide Town population him. You know, pretty much that what comes down to him. He just becomes a nuisance, and he's going to get exploded.
Yeah. But what you have to remember, we're probably talking about the Bulba clockwork here, and that clockwork on Bulba was one of the reasons I've kind of fallen in love with Bulba in the first place. I mean, he's so freaking talented in this hero, not just in this hero, but I mean, back when clockwork was really popular for quite a while ago.
A couple patches ago.
People like Bulba and Kabu and these, there were some players who could just take clockwork, take the game, combine those, and just blow the game open for everyone else. There's so much that someone like Bulba can do, and I'm really looking forward to seeing him, seeing him at the wheel, controlling that clockwork once again here, especially with the amount of support that he already has with the Scarab Mage as an next pick. So,
yeah, I would say Bulba is one of those players who gets pretty much clockwork. And usually the most important part about the clockwork is the fact that you try to keep up with the tempo of the game and try to not fall behind. That's pretty much what clockwork is about. It's just pretty much go snowball heavy, which pretty much it's all over Team Tinker's history, you could say, you know, with Koifa on top of like Way to Empire and even Black to some degree. I mean, you can read snowball all over the place. You know that these guys, if they're able to get a little bit of an advantage, they can take a mile and they can just run up with a game. Easy peasy.
Speaking of running here, we have the Spirit Breaker picked up for Void Boys. And what do you think about that? I mean, up against the Clockwork, you do have the Cox to worry about, so you're not really charging him. Queen of Pain has the Blink out, which is not going to stop the charge, but which might make you cancel it because it was a little bit too deep behind enemy lines.
I would say it gives a lot of intel, I think. It's the fact that I feel like the broken part about the Spirit Breaker is the fact that when he's charging you, you don't know it.
Yeah.
So the sniper the Clockwork or the Queen of Pain might get a little bit too excited or a little bit too ambitious for their own sake, while the guys of Void Boys will have, you know, will have a good tell about where is who and, you know, the location and whom or who he's rolling with, you know, who is around him and such. And it could be the surprise factor, I think, is the most important part of any Spirit Breaker player, is the fact that you need to exploit that surprise factor. They cannot see you coming, and you're going to try to make them not expect you at all as a Spirit Breaker player. I think that's a key factor for them. Also, Spirit Breaker is one of those weird offlanes that can actually scale pretty well as a right clicker in the late game. It doesn't happen often, though. I mean, either you win pretty early with a extra vision and pretty much gank control or initiation control, you could say, or you just fail miserably and the Spirit Breaker just doesn't go anywhere. So that's pretty much the two sides of the coin so far. But I wouldn't put him behind him. I mean, because this guy with enough attack speed, he's just the bachelord of hell.
That's one redeeming factor of the Spirit Breaker. I mean, I used to think, I mean, you're always going to get something out of him because, I mean, you have this greater bash. Sure, it's only a 17% chance, but the thing is, you get at least one free one from the Charge of Darkness, and you also get a bash from Nether Strike, and then with a little bit of attack speed, at least going to get one extra bash between that. So, and that's a decent decent stun duration just because of that.
Yeah, the stun duration itself, I think, is the most ridiculous part, because it's not only the stun, which is 1.6, level 4, is the fact that you also have a knockback on top of that. It really, really offsets you as a right clicker, especially as a melee carry. But I don't know how this is going to fare off and if we are able to reach to that. Actually, the Abaddon pick, I think, is really good with the Sniper and the Vengeful Spirit, particularly versus a Clockwork and a Scarlet Mage, because it really offsets most of the initiations that Team Tinker could or would love to strive for, pretty much.
Yeah, well placed aphotic shields here, just being able to purge any sort of debuffs or stuns. Can just bait someone like a Sniper out pretty damn quickly in the early game. And this game with the Sand King picked up now on top of that as well, a hero that will normally buy a Blink Dagger, and all this magic damage that's coming out already. Wouldn't be too surprised to see a Sniper actually go for a quick BKB. Saw it in a different game the other day, and up against a similar lineup, up against like someone like a Clockwork plus a lot of heavy magic damage focus heroes, so big BKB for Sniper would actually mean that he can't really be touched, especially if you have a little bit of extra healing from the Abaddon on top of that.
Well, here's the problem though, is like, you wanna, I mean, on this stage I would say like, yeah, I mean, the Sniper is gonna probably go with a BKB. The problem is like, well, it's gonna take a while to get a BKB, especially because you want to get at least a Yasha to farm up, or boots and a Ring of Aquila or something on the like. And during that time, you're pretty much a Team Tinker's will.
Yeah,
unless you have the Abaddon next to you. I mean, there's no two ways about it.
That's true. And if you go BKB, that means that your damage output is going to be delayed or at least gimmed for a little bit. So you do need another carry in the mid game to kind of tide you over. And in Spirit Breaker, Eventual Spirit, Abaddon, Spirit Breaker can maybe sort of do it, but not really.
Mm-hmm. Not now with that Phantom Assassin pick, which I feel like is amazing, because the Sniper is like, okay, I'm gonna get a BKB and I'm pretty in touch. Well, not really now, buddy. And even though Sniper really first on a 1v1 lane scenario pretty well versus Phantom Assassin, later on, Phantom Assassin just rips him a new one if she's able to land his sights onto him. Again, the Spirit Breaker could be a really decent counter versus Phantom Assassin as long as he's able to get something like an MKB, but we're talking about 60-minute mark or 50+, so I don't think it ain't gonna happen.
Well, there's a counter for you. There's the Razor here up against the Phantom Assassin, and yeah, that's a reasonable pickup, actually, because if you do get that tether going, that means the Phantom Assassin will want to get the hell out, break the tether before re-engaging, or else just lose all the damage. Question is, how does it fit into the rest of the lineup? And I do think it would fit rather well here. Whether you put him in the safe lane or mid, doesn't really matter. That is the kind of carry that can provide that extra bit of damage that you need, especially if you want to go for that quick BKB on a Sniper. And not to mention the pushing power it gives as well from the ultimate once it hits. It's an Aghanim Scepter, the teamfight potential that comes with that, just to complement the Sniper, and just also be that frontline hero, even. I mean, Razor can get quite tanky here.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I feel like that's a little bit more of a drawback to a Razor than anything else, because Razor will have to be the tanky hero here. Razor does rely heavily to have like a really good economic lead, whether it be by kills or by farm alone, and just try to get those early frontline items. If he doesn't, he's just a ragdoll. He's just simply like, okay, I guess you're a Razor, we're gonna just, stun you away, drop a Mystic Flare, Mystic Flare on top of you, and be done with you. You know, and it's like, well, there goes that guy. You know, so actually I feel like There is some amount of pressure on the Razor. However, the good side of that is he's a lane dominator.
That's what I thought here. Early smoke. They will find out Black. The stun goes off. Can they get in sort of follow desert charge? We'll keep him in place for a little bit longer. It takes quite a bit of damage already, but the teammate was there. Black forced the skill, the Phantom Strike, but it's enough to keep him safe. But early smoke a little bit wasted for Void Boys here.
Yeah, I mean, the upside would be that that Black got forced into Phantom Strike level 1, which I guess it limits a little bit his harassing potential. But depending on which lane you're going to pair him up with, he might not care, to be honest.
So let's take a quick look at the lineups here before we proceed. We've got Mercy, Please on the Razor here, kind of contesting for this bottom rune here. There's a stun actually on Xuan. And kind of locked in, he has to walk the other way.
The battle begins.
Nothing will come of it though, so yeah. The Razor, played by Mercy, Please, has eventually been shooed off this bottom lane here. Duan, as mentioned, on the Ventral Spirit, Fly, playing the Abaddon. 747 on the Sniper, which leaves the offlane for a Megapona on the Spirit Breaker.
On the side of Team Tinker, we're gonna have Koifa with the Queen of Pain, just, rocking that solo lane, which should go his way, I would assume, especially because he's really good at solo lanes. Black is going to be on the Phantom Assassin on the middle lane, all with a really quick smoke, actually, both supports of the Team Tinker side, which is going to be Pink Panda or Way Too Sexy, whatever you want to call it, followed by Paladai with the Skyrim Mage, and last but not least, Bulba or Flo with the Clockwork.
There's a stun, no battery soul, but the cogs are there. Yeah, and there's the first blood. A little bit anticlimactic as it did take them an extra second or so. As he did want to give that kill to that offlane Clockwork, propel him to level 2, but yeah, first blood nonetheless, going the way of Team Tinker, so already good start. Especially since he supports, he has staying for a while, just making sure that this Clockwork gets to a quick level 6, gets a little bit of extra farm early on.
Mm-hmm. And here's again the problem is like, do you remember what I just said a couple minutes ago about the Razor needing an economic lead in order to actually have a good impact towards the mid game, especially into the late game? Well, getting first blood like this, it's arguably the worst case scenario for you. Even if they did, I mean, I think that's even a better kill than getting the sniper in the middle. Even though it sounds a little bit weird, but just the fact that Sniper is more manageable, and speaking of Sniper...
They are getting Sniper in middle, yeah. they still have a Burst Strike if they want to use it, they might have to know. Yeah, just being very economic there with the money, even just knowing that Black will have another dagger to finish him off. So once again, very well played, very good rotation. Mm-hmm. And well in bottom. Bulba locks Fly in here a little bit in the cogs just to get the rune here. Very well played.
Nice, nice move. But yeah, I mean, they're just this is the perfect plan coming from Team Tinker, is the fact that you're gonna try to abuse as much as possible your supports and get as many rotations as humanly possible, and just take out two of the most susceptible heroes, at least playing from behind.
Seven, and trouble seven. Again, slowed down by the dagger, but now he's on the run. Boots already
charge,
happened.
Though.
Yeah. Charge. He has to stop that, though. Under attack.
Okay.
He got through with that, and Way Too Sexy would have probably just been able to throw out the Burst Strike, and then that Spirit Breaker would have been the one being bursted down instead.
Yeah. In the meantime, though, I really like what the initiative or that pretty much the setup from Team Tinker is, which is let's not try to do stacks and pulls and all that stuff. We know we have good enough players on the individual lane, at least on individual skills, controlling their lanes properly. So we're just pretty much gonna try to do little single pulls. Maybe force a couple pushes here on top of that, but mostly just focusing on getting early kills and just try to win both lanes.
Yep.
At least what it is, bottom and middle.
I mean, you know that you don't really have to go to the top lane unless you want to get a little bit of extra XP out of the jungle, which is what Way Too Sexy is doing now for the time being. Because, I mean, you can see it here in the last, it's 24-17, last and denies up against 4-0 of his lane opponents here on Megapona. You know that a Queen of Pain will win this matchup, so what you can do is focus on the bottom here, Bulba alone, of course, can be quite tricky as a clockwork sometimes. And of course also focus on the middle here with the sniper who is inherently in the favorite the favorite hero here in this kind of matchup up against the melee hero, the Phantom Assassin. Even though you do have the dagger to get a couple of extra last hits. But I think it was really the rotations here, the constant pressure that's being put on. Even if it's just threat of another gank to make 7-for-7 play a little bit more defensively here. For now, gives Black the advantage in terms of CS.
Also, the fact is that, 7-for-7 does have the advantage as a sniper on the laning stage up until level 6 on the Phantom Assassin.
Yeah.
Moment that Black hits level 6, 7-for-7 needs to be scared of as hell. Because a quick jump and a couple of lucky criticals could be the death of him. So I think that the plan coming from Void Voice is pretty much try to maybe squeeze a kill out of Quaifa, which is going to be a little bit tricky, even with the help of Xuan onto the top lane. But yeah, try to get maybe a quick kill onto Quaifa or onto the supports. Speaking of the supports of Team Tinker, they're going to go bottom here. Good burrow strike.
A little bit misplaced, but maybe not. Maybe they want to get the mana burn.
I think that was with purpose. Yeah.
And it's Bull, but I don't want. He doesn't make mistakes on this hero. He just doesn't.
Yeah.
Don't want to say it was on purpose.
Maybe the only mistake he could have made is that miscalculation of damage. Yeah. You know, with the pushback, is like, he might actually survive with 10 health points. Hit point, sorry. But that's about it, and now they're gonna probably rotate again towards
the rotation, and 7-for-7 does get caught from behind once more. And that sounded even worse than I actually wanted to. But he does die once again, so 1-2 punch, get the Razor, rotate mid, get the Sniper, rotate into the own jungle, do a stack, maybe do it up in the jungle here. The very efficient time spent on the side of the Tinker supports right now.
Yeah, I mean, already Sand King is halfway through his Blink Dagger. Just by assist goal alone, I think. Let's see, did he got any kill on this? Yeah, he got a kill and 3 assists, but still. I mean, he's just doing fine, and he could actually get a Blink Dagger on the 10 minutes if, you know, they're able to keep it up. Or if just they start stacking a couple of extra camps for Way 2. And, he could get a pre-10-minute Blink Dagger. However, at the same time, Team Tinker don't have that rush, I would say, either. They're sitting pretty comfortably. They know that they're winning the lanes, at least two of them. And no, actually three of them, because Quaifa is just demolishing that Spirit Breaker on top, so...
He's having complete free bomb, and
yeah.
It's only 7 minutes in, barely, so I don't really want to take it. I don't really want to look at the net worth already, but you see on the net worth as well as the last hits, they're pulling ahead pretty damn quickly. On all of their three core heroes. Quaifa here on top, of course. Just having complete free farm, which means a quick Orchid. Probably here on the Queen of Pain. Clockwork also having a really good time, already level 6 here. And Razor, not even there. And then, of course, mid. Of course, being helped out tremendously by the support rotations, but Black is getting the farm that he needs, and more importantly, the level that he needs. Be able to start, join the fights, and maybe get a pickoff or two on the back of some help from the supports.
Yeah, at the same time, there's a little surprise sitting here, which is, well, Glad. And knowing Bulba, he's going to take full advantage of that rune in no time. So I wouldn't be surprised about this. Again, this is the problem with Razor. Look at Razor here. He's like, he has threats and a stick.
Yeah,
that's pretty much that it is for Mercy Please, and there is no way you can tank with that. Oh, but they're gonna actually be charging Bulb, and he's gonna pop the haste preemptively. So I was about to say, yeah, he's just gonna go full aggressive with this haste, but no need. In the meantime, Black actually is gonna get the kill onto the sniper.
Base created. There's a hookshot here, Solid in the main map. He does catch a Mega Pwn, and the Battery Soul is going on an isolated target. Does still get bashed out thanks to the stun. But he could still fall to one. He might fall as well, but Fly with rotation around. He was too late to save the sniper. There's another kill that he barely caught, but he was there in time to secure the life of his fellow support at the very least. But still, sniper going down, Spirit Breaker going down again.
Yeah, a Clover with a haste is terrifying, man. Yeah. He's just terrifying. Especially with a guy like Bulba. It's like he could have made a second trade if it wasn't for Fly. And even then, I think he could have even gone for the Abaddon set, but maybe that would have been a little bit too tricky for him because he could have ate up a magic missile and, you know, more unpleasant stuff. But at the same time, again, Black just hauling ass right here in the mid, on this mid lane, and 747 needs to be extra careful because, again, couple of lucky crits and it could be just rip sniper all over the place, you know. Easy peasy. Fly is the only saving grace for 747 because I think Black knows that the Abaddon is behind him, so that's why he's not jumping him. But if he wasn't, and if he sees Fly by any chance or any other place on the map, I think 747 is just as good as dead. Yep. I mean, the potential damage that Black can deliver on him is just going to be insane. Also, he's going for a Barrow Fury, just as a side note.
Even then, Fly, that poor player, he's only level 2. Pretty damn close to level 3, but he's still level 2, 10 minutes in, and it's... Even on an Abaddon, who's super obnoxious to deal with. I mean, level 1 Phoenix Shield, ultimately, it's not that scary at this point in the game. Even if you want, to get in close. Doesn't really... I mean, it can still screw you over if it just breaks your stun combo.
They're charging Bulba here, but no.
That's getting some vision, I suppose.
No, they were setting up to it, but Bulba kind of read a little bit the situation, and he just backed off. I think if he went back to the bottom lane, you know, towards the rear, just grabbing the rune and getting the back again, I think they would have proceeded with the engagement, but they didn't. So, I mean, they're like, well, if this Spirit Breakers keep charging, he will be too deep, and then it's just going to be just pretty awkward. Okay. Also, Black has a double damage rune as well, so and an invisibility rune, I mean, illusion rune, also packed up into his bottle, so... Yeah. I mean, he's
quite Christmas time for Team Tinker right now. I mean, Black has that illusion, as you said, in his bottle. A pink panda. Way too sexy. Just picked up his blink target, smoked up. There we go, showing it off already. And yeah, Koikva showing off his new little toy as well. The Dagon that he just finished up as his first item. We'd love to see some stats on that. Unfortunately, we didn't get a stats one for tonight. But yeah, and Clockwork, at the same time, pretty much finished up the Blade Mail. So now, probably looking for a hook in his middle lane. There's four heroes here, but I don't think they care at this point. They get some more rotations in, and... Yeah, think on top of the world right now. Way to might get caught, but by whom? There's this charge coming out. Still has the Sandstorm, still has the Burst Strike, and the Blink, of course, and now might be teammated into a trap here. Omega Panda does not get the Metal Strike off. Battery Assault. Super annoying to deal with.
Yeah, so Spirit Breaker Battery Assault is just insane to deal with. If there is any testament to it, just look at Fails of the Week. Just the amount of sheer rage for a Spirit Breaker is just insane.
2-1. There we go.
Okay!
I was thinking about it again. Should I really kill him? Should I just... Oh, wow. Bulba, please. Please, Bulba. Didn't see that. I didn't see it. Legacy will not be tarnished.
Well, upside of this is, it's a 12-minute blade mail for Bulba, on top of his tranquils. And bottle.
One charge mid, teleports come out. Highlight Eye might be a little bit of trouble. Gets the silence off. Epicenter's channel, that's the blink. That's the burrow strike. No. Doesn't even need it. Pilot Eye will fall, but so will the Spirit Breaker. Pink Panda and Wedge Sexy, a little bit of trouble, but Quarkwa cleaning house on the backline here brings down another target. Not the target that you wanted though. 747 still on the hunt, but Quarkwa blink forward. There's gonna be the Dagon plus the Scream of Pain, or whatever it's called. Yeah, Scream of Pain. He will fall to the tower here. Being stunned up right under it, a little bit unfortunate.
Wow,
yeah, that actually makes it a really good trade for Void Boys, all things considered. Considering how far behind they are. A little bit of extra gold going the way of these staff supports.
Yeah, I think that was a pretty decent trade for them. They still paid dearly to it, but I mean, I guess that was great. I think if Black was down, would have been down there, that whole team would just, you know, just turns in the favor of Team Tinker, easy peasy. I think that the fact is that Team Tinker kind of overstretched themselves a little bit because they thought that there were lesser people on that mid lane from Void Boys and maybe overestimated. Oh, Bulba! Just gonna jump into Mercy, please, and he ain't gonna have any mercy. Just battering us, just battery assault. Good swap, though, but just
was
not
it?
Enough.
Was it a good swap, though?
Man, the doo-doo-doo is too strong, man. Doo-doo-doo is too strong.
It was that was one of the swaps where you would, in hindsight, you would say, all right, that was maybe not worth it because, hey, a Razor still dies and then you put yourself in, still put yourself in a bad position anyway, so...
Nading an I mean, here's the deal.
Fly, he's gonna fall too. There's the burst strike flow on Bulba here. Ouch. White Bar just finishes it off with a Dagon instead. So
here's the deal as an Abaddon, though. I mean, is the fact that okay, if you're level 2 is not the back of is not the worst of deals, just because the Photic Shield can come up with you. The problem is like that period between level like 2 or 3 into level 6 is
I thought this bottom lane misses the stun. There's a swap back into tower lane. Charge comes out on they focusing all their stuff here on the Sand King. Will bring him down, but Quagmire still waiting inside flow. The Bulba gets the cogs off onto Megapunter once more with the help of Final Die. Will bring him down. Quagmire still waiting for chance to pounce here. Will use it to go on Sniper here as Bulba dies in back and Quagmire actually. What?
Sniper? What?
Headshot's too strong. What happened there?
He tried to right click the sniper, but because he had like minus 1,000 attack speed, she was like,
please.
And tried again and
wanted to punch him straight up, but it ended up being just slaps. Not enough to bring him down. But the thing is, Quarkfire had his ultimate the whole time. Could have just used that. But
yeah, I think that.
If he had enough mana.
Yeah, I think he underestimated the amount of hit points that the sniper can have. And you know, the 1,000 hit points that he had, maybe a little bit again of a miscalculation. I think Quaifa thought that, okay, Dagon and Scroll of Pain should be able to kill you, even, I mean, especially with the Mask of Madness triggered up. But I think it either ran down or again just a quick miscalculation on the damage. I would assume. So instead of just popping the ult, and I don't even thought that he had the mana for it. He just tried to right click and then the headshot factor came into it. It's like, well, I guess I'm SOL. So.
Well, there's Overshot coming in soon. There we go, that's one I don't want to see. Gets Mercy, please. Yeah, no, they must play a little bit off target. Should still be able to bring him down. Charge comes in, that's a bad idea, Megapona. Get the hell out of there, Quagmire. Nice silence on top of that, amplifying that damage. Bring him down quickly, but Paladai will fall to the sniper. Stun up on the Queen of Pain, has to get the hell out of there. Pretty damn now, but the assassinate still on him here.
He's
that should be able to bring
it
out. But no, Bulba once again gets 747, interrupts everything. Plus the doo doo doo. That's another death. Gets a stun on Xuan here. Quagmire coming back in. Back in for more here. Xuan tries to turn and fight. Quagmire misses that he has an ultimate. Uses it, but that hero creep. That hero creep.
Yeah.
Got the last hit. But no one got experience for it, so I guess it's.
Yeah,
okay,
and consider that it was a 5-4-2. Here's the deal. This is a 5-4-2, right? Which is kind of like, okay, it's not horrible trade for Weibos, but it's pretty damn abysmal. Well, consider this. Black hasn't been on both team on the both of the previous team fights here. He has been just AFK farming.
Yeah,
so,
he's a 2-0-1 on a team that has 20 kills.
Yeah, exactly.
He's still
saying
from network charge.
Think about it.
That's black for you. It's just black.
Yeah, but also think about the rest of the lineup. It's like, well, we're able to get pretty good trades on our own, even on a 4v5 scenario.
Yeah.
That's a scary thought for Void Blitz, if there's any. Yeah. How do you... Again, consider... Here's the deal. 747 right now has 6 skills. 4 of those skills, I think, were on the previous team fights, if not 5, right?
Yep.
Imagine if they had black on the back of this. I think 747 would have get blown up immediately. And I would assume that Queen of Pain wouldn't have died in both of those team fights as well. So Quaifa would have been like, 8-1, and 747 would be like probably 1-5.
Another hookshot, another target. Mercy, please, gets blown off by the Mystic Flare. Bulba will finish him off. Megapona gets caught out, signs up here. Under the cover of Doodoo Doo, tries to blow the Nether Strike, will do it on Paladai, so he will fall. That's a noble sacrifice here in this instance. Quagmire, they had to finish the job, and now 747 actually laying down a charge. No one's actually been able to bring him down. Gets the assassinated off, Bulba is down. Quagmire on the run.
Uh-oh.
Always something that you always have to keep in mind. Double epicenter here, double burst strike, and now Quagmire once again pouncing back. Finishing
here
the job,
back.
Gets another stun here. Moe gets a nigh as Xuan. Nah, he will be the consolation kill. Black will claim that as he finally decides to join the fight. But yeah, another 5-man wipe, but another cute little play there. And Abaddon being able to deny himself. That last 5-man wipe, there was a creep getting the counter kill. But still, Team Tinker. I mean, they do lose Bulba, but he's a hero that can die at this point. He has the blade mill already. He has level 12.
Radiance and then I think if I'm Bulba, I'm just going for a straight scepter.
Yeah.
Or a four step before a scepter, but still. On the other hand, just look at this German little friend of ours, old black. Oh yeah, by the way, I already have on top of my Battle Fury and threats. Mask of Madness, oh, and an Aegis in the meantime, while all of that happened, and still sitting almost 3,000 gold. This is a problem, and that's kind of an understatement here, but God, I mean, I just feel like Void Boys, as soon as Vlad decides to engage on them, they're just going to get destroyed by this Phantom Assassin, especially if she's able to get a BKB on the next, like, 5 to 7 minutes. There's no answer to this. There is, like, no answer to this, especially because they have been focused. If you notice, most of the engagements have started because they have been focusing on Mercy Please. So this Razor is just sitting at 1,300 hit points, which is not so shabby, but at the same time, considering that it's a 20-minute mark, yeah, and that's your frontliner.
Yeah.
I don't think that's cutting it, especially, again, looking at Black, looking at what Koifa is packing, which is a Dagon level 4. So... critical mass is starting to reach towards the damage output of that of Team Tinker. Even then, they do still have a lot of growth on that on this lineup. I mean, Spinapink could get an Aghanim's. There's Dagon 5, so even then, that's even worse. Bulba could get, again, his Aghanim's, which would make team fights even easier to engage into. Which I think, yeah, after a 4-7 is going to be his attempt. A Veil, even on the Sand King, could work wonders here. And again, Black is just, well, I mean, you can do so much.
Black is kind of the backup plan here, and, that, and if you consider that, if your highest farm on your team is a Phantom Assassin, sitting at 13,000 gold points now, and you don't even need him to win the fights, then, yeah, that says a lot about, I mean, also the movement that you just saw from Void Boys. You saw the Rocket Fly coming out from Bulba, scouting out, and then immediately Void Boys just grouped up his five, went back into their own base. They didn't want to get caught out again. And that just, in turn, opens up more space for Black to farm, more space for everyone else to start doing whatever they want. In this case, it is pushing down this tier 2 tower. Void Boys in no position to fight this here.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, what do you do as Void Boys? Here's the really million-dollar question. And, I mean, it's really hard to try to make an argument for them right now. It's not because you're kind of, you know, we're biased towards Team Tinker or anything. It's just the fact that, well, the game is just not developing their way. I mean, I guess if 747 is able to... Well, he does have a pretty decent amount of damage. And if he's able to try to peel away a couple of enemy heroes, especially Paladai. Paladai should be a pretty easy pickings for him. Well, never mind, he has a Ghost Scepter. But... again, if he doesn't pay attention, or, you know, he pops his Ghost up to prematurely, I guess 747 should get an easy kill here.
Smoke is being broken, though. This will scatter
out. They're ready.
So. Yeah, they want to fight here. Xuan almost blown up. Now he will be.
Oh my god.
Oh, Mercy Please once again caught in the Coxie. Quite well, though, locked down thanks to the Spirit Breaker, but Black joining the fight once more. 747. Caught between a rock and a hard place, or kind of two trees, and a lot of heroes. Triple kill for
what's
him,
say,
as he
to
starts putting some points
on
the board.
A black place, you could say. Wow. Well, actually, I really like this itemization for Spellbreaker. Going for a full blade mail could actually make Black kill himself on the team fights. It's just the fact that, well, your frontline period is just non-existent.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, this Razor has been getting ganked up too many times, so his item growth is quite meh. I mean, he can take some of it, but versus what Black is right now packing, I don't think it's enough. Sniper is trying to do the best as he can, and to be fair, I mean, he's close to his BKB, which is going to be quite significant for him in order to at least defend high ground, which I guess should be the plan for Void Boys.
I think once he gets the BKB, the things will change a little bit. He's still 1600 off. But once he gets that, he doesn't really have to care about all the magic damage. If he pops it early enough, and Black isn't already on top of him, Black is going to have a little bit of a harder time actually chasing him down. And we've seen it before in the teamfights. Whenever there was any sort of damage coming out, it was from the sniper. He does have the damage to bring down someone like a Quagmire if he blinked in aggressively.
It's just the fact that if you're able to weather a storm, I feel. If they're able to do that somehow, which is going to be quite difficult, but I mean, they do have a high ground defense, hypothetically, and I mean, Sniper is pretty good at high ground defense, and most of this meta is centered around if you're able to accomplish the high ground push, or if the enemy team is able to, you know, just run out with the defense and pretty much turtle up ad infinitum. I mean, I guess Void would still have a shot is the fact that, well, if they're getting cut up, especially because 747 is out of his base and there's no one literally next to him, yeah, this is what you don't want to see happening, and that's just brutal. That should ensure at least the tier 2 towers all over the place. Well, never mind, they only have one, so they could try to wrestle
this.
There's
a charge, he says, oh wow.
Okay, yeah, that happened.
He had enough of this, so he just sacrificed him. What? Okay, it's just Black insta-giving people.
Black also has a BKB, so that happened.
Fly will only survive on the back of his ultimate. Black chasing him all the way back. Wow! Hello! That was a long-range sonic wave.
I feel like for that particular kind of kill, we should queue up a soundbite of Seinfeld just going with the hello voice. Hello!
Oh, hi, by the way, I know that how my ultimate works now. I can use that. It's a 5-1 wipe, that's a set of racks, and frankly, it's probably GG time soon once more.
We can take a quick look at the ground. I think they have a defense left in them. I think that they can defend at least one lane of racks, but this should be at least two lanes.
Yeah, I mean, to what end? You can defend, maybe, but to what end? Black is doubling the net worth of your sniper right now, almost. Mm. He has an Abyssal Blade, for crying out loud. 26 minute Abyssal Blade on top of Battle Fury, BKB, and Mask of Madness.
I feel like that the end would be like try to get the sniper 6 slotted, try to get Mercy, please, if not alive through the team fights, at least trying to make a favorable trade for him and just maybe ensure an Aghanim's or a BKB or both somehow, and maybe get the Spiritbreaker 6 slotted, which could happen, but they need to stall this like at least 20 minutes and the problem is like they're getting out of position.
Way too here. That would be a good start. Get stunned up. Quagmire's still around, but he doesn't really want to fight up against everyone here. Oh, cancel the teleport, trying to walk even further with the assassin on top of him. That's a gem down even.
All right, okay,
a good kill, but that took a 5-minute rotation. And there's the Aghanim assassin now on clockwork. The Bulba can just throw out hooks every 12 seconds. It is, yeah,
I mean, it's better than nothing. The thing is, Tinker, at least knowing the players a little bit, I feel like those are the kind of players who are not gonna let the pressure off, especially with this amount of just advantage that they have. I mean, look at Black. He's invisible. He's running through 4 to 5 enemy heroes here.
He doesn't give a shit, man.
Die, though.
Let's get stunlocked a little bit here by a Megapone, and now focusing on the targeted hand, swap out with the Aphonic Shield, and it's not enough. Mercy, please. Next one on the list. Big crit, another big crit! Black now, another bash, another lucky bash here, or what was it, charge, I guess. Black might fall here, maybe not, 4 stuff out, more Quagmire joining the party here. What the, he's still alive and he's running back home to heal up, while the rest of the team picks up the slack here. Quagmire gets another, I don't even know at whom at this point here, it was a Megapone, and now Bulba once again, doing what he has been doing the entire game, catching Mercy, please, in the cogs.
Oh, hello.
GG is called, and what a good game it was. Not the Void Boys that I was, that I know that they, what they could do. Not the ones that I was expecting, but definitely as a little bit of a Tinker fanboy, great, great game to watch, at least from that perspective. So,
I mean, it was just the, I don't know, man. I feel like for Void Boys it was a particular pickoff strat, but when you're getting actually, when you're getting your position 1 and position 2 ganked like 3 minutes in a row, every single time that they popped out, and you have a Spirit Breaker that it just doesn't work for you, man. It just, that's, it's like getting out push with a Pugna lineup, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
is one of those things that cannot happen, and if it happens, it's like, what can we do? Well, it's really limited. I mean, I did like a little bit more this draft, but at the same time, again, the problem is like heroes like Razor and Sniper, particularly the Sniper, was like really, he didn't have too many escape mechanisms. He did hold his ground, but again, it's the fact that the rest of the lineup just got demolished, especially Mercy, Please, 0-10, and I cannot blame it onto the guy. It's just the fact that Razor is one of those heroes that you want to win the lane, try to snowball it economically, and then get the big items like a heart, like a BKB, like a scepter, and work your way through it. And if you're able to snowball heavily as a Razor, we have seen time and time again, especially on TI4, you're able to just command the enemy, the whole team fights. But if it happens like this, you're getting ganked up left, right, and center. You are arguably one of the worst heroes that there is on any draft, because pretty much you're like your idea is to sit on the front lines. But if you're getting insta-gived by Black, well, that doesn't do too much, huh? So yeah. I mean, Fly tried his best again. I mean, as an Abaddon, I think he did a pretty good job as well. But it's just the fact that you didn't get any early momentum, you didn't get any early big kills, I would assume. And by the time that they did, Black was already on critical mass. Yeah. 12-0. So.
Fly as well, they didn't give him any priority in terms of levels. I mean, even when Sniper was farming up the jungle with Shrapnel a little bit, Fly was just rotating around, trying to find what little farm he could on the top lane here at that point. So he was sitting on level 2 for so long, and even he ended with a single digit level here, level 9, and I think that might have ended up also contributing to the demise, just him not being able to find anything, not being able to find the levels to actually make his spells worthwhile going into 10-15 minutes.
Yeah, also the fact that when you have a lineup with the Spirit Breaker, you need to find any openings for kills, and Team Tinker kind of they positioned themselves well in order to just not give any read to Omega Powder to just charge into someone. So when he was charging someone, he's like, yeah, you know what, I'm not going to go through with this because it looks pretty deep and I'm not just going to dive into that. And I mean, it's just good read from Team Tinkering to never overextend too much onto positioning, at least while they were on the laning phase. They did overextend on the team fights, but again, they were 4v5 team fights, so, you know, they kind of had to at that stage. But it's just the fact that, the Omega Founder didn't have a really any good, like, engagement window, any good read into, you know, try to get, like, way too by himself or try to get Pilot Die killed. I mean, damn, when Pilot Die only dies 4 times, you know your aggression is thwarted. You know, that's all I'm saying, you know? But,
all right.
I'm just gonna end it like that, man, because people will be like, what the hell are you trying to say? Well, I'm just saying Pilot Die kinda dies a lot. Sorry.
We could talk long and wide about this match and how it's been going and how it's been going so well in favor of Team Tinker, but I mean, you've all seen it. If you didn't, check out the VODs as soon as they go up. And also head over to joindota.com to find out exactly when it is. That's also where you find all the other info that you can possibly need about this tournament. This is, of course, the joindota MLG Pro League Season 2. We're heading straight into it here as the LAN finals are coming up in June, at the beginning of June here at X Games in Austin. So, yeah, Tinker with a good start. Void Boys will fall down to the lower bracket here in their first game, and they definitely have to change a lot if they want to make it further down there. Tinker, though, are going to await the winner of Pain versus NAR in the upper bracket semifinals next. So once again, head over to joindota.com, hover over the league, and then click on the JD MLG Pro League, and that's where you can find all the brackets, all the results, everything that you need. Alright, on that note, thank you very much for watching. I was Wayne Castle here, my name is DragonDrop. You can find me on Twitter at DragonDropDota. And Rupture, where can they find you?
You can find me with Rupture with a 3 instead of an E. And of course, I'll be on my merry way to eat some tacos because I need to be stereotypical enough. But yeah, also, go Brazil! So, Pain Gaming, please, you have my rares. Do not screw this up, man. Please. Fingers crossed. Thank you.
I'm gonna play one more song and then I say good night. So, it's DragonDrop signing off.